I'm Tom Mison, and I'm at MCM Birmingham. I'm loving it. We started the day with, I got to meet everyone and signed a few things, and I've just done my first lap of the floor. I left my wallet out of my pocket, but I've planned everything that I'm going to spend too much money on a bit later. It was the one promise I made when I came here, was that I wouldn't spend all my money on things, but I've already seen too much that I want. Well, actually, rather than questions, there have been lots of congratulations this time, because a few days ago we just heard that we've been picked up for a season 3. So it's nice to see that there are lots of people pleased with that, rather than people coming up and saying, oh God, a third one. So that's nice to have lots of congratulations. With season 2, I believe we've just had the what is known as the mid-season finale, where John Noble's character, who is Henry, my son, has just stabbed the demon Moloch with the sword of Methuselah, of course. And so now, potentially, the apocalypse is over. And the big question now is, what does Ichabod do now that the apocalypse is over, when his whole purpose has been to thwart it? So Ichabod and Abby will now have to find a new direction. Or will they? Well, Ichabod's kind of settled into the 21st century to an extent. And he's got used to the workings of people around him more than anything. They're now more familiar with their mission as witnesses. They know what they have to do. So there's a real picking up of the pace because of that. But then, of course, now that Moloch could be dead, what do they do with that pace? It's very difficult to answer questions about season 3 because I know what's coming up at the end of season 2 and I don't want any spoilers. I think the show works. The show's at its very best when effectively it's a horror show. I would like to see in season 3 it become very scary. There were some episodes in the first season where people would say that they were frightened by it. That it made them jump, or it was really tense for them. That's what I want back. You'll see an episode coming up in a few weeks. I can't remember what the episode was called, but there are these creatures called Reavers who are created by a certain someone in the past to protect a certain building from the past. I'm trying not to give spoilers. The Reavers frightened me because there's lots of them. They've got like fish hooks that hold their eyes open and their lips have all gone away, and they just run at you, and it surprised me because I didn't know they were going to run at me screaming, trying to attack me. So on the first take, I don't think I'm allowed to say I shat myself, but I shat myself. They're scary. I think that's the scariest. There's loads of them. Plus, you know, the headless horseman, when he's riding at you on a horse with an axe, his horse is massive. And we've got a brilliant guy called Craig, who is the head. We have three headless horsemen. We have Craig, who is the headless horseman on a horse. We have Jeremy, who's the headless horseman off a horse. And then we have Neil, of course, who is the headless horseman with a head. And they're all excellent, and they all seem to love attacking me in different ways. We're very lucky with the cast. I've thought it from the beginning. When I signed up to the first season, they'd already cast Nicole, who I was already a fan of, and they'd already cast Katia, who, by weird coincidence, we were in an episode of Lewis together years and years ago. So already I knew that it would be a classy cast and a fun cast. And then the more people who have come to join us, just I think the luckier we've been. And I think that's part of what will allowed the show some longevity, I think, is it's a group of actors who just like playing with each other. If you'll excuse the phrase. Yeah, there are lots of supernatural shows, but the thing that Sleepy Hollow has, I think, is that it doesn't take itself too seriously. There's always levity, and rarely is it at the expense of the show. The joke isn't about the show. The show gets the joke. So the characters can be in very dangerous, threatening situations, and we can play that as very, very real. But the show knows its own absurdity, which is quite uncommon, even out of genre shows. That's just something you don't see very often. And I suspect that's a large part of its success. We do have a lot of fun. As I said, we're very lucky with the cast, but it's hard work. When you've got 12 pages and it's just exposition explaining about the goblet of something or other that Thomas Jefferson found in such and such a date. I'm not very good at remembering dates, and I have loads of dates to remember. So there's pages of exposition, and then you're running through forests at 3 a.m, getting bitten by North Carolinian mosquitoes. You kind of have to have a laugh afterwards, because otherwise you'd go quite insane. I like to think I'm not like Ichabod. Often if I meet people and I complain about something, they go, that's Ichabod. So I try not to dislike things. He's moody, and he's occasionally very selfish, and he's cantankerous, and I hope I'm not any of those things. Yeah, he's also heroic, and he's loyal, and so I'll go with that. Yes, I'm like Ichabod because I'm heroic. Fortunately, it's not one of those shows where they say, you've got the part, now you've got to go to the gym for 6 months. I'm very relieved with that. I'm not a fan of gyms. So no, that's not any preparation. I don't need to bulk up for this, which is fortunate. The second season is slightly different to the first. There was an attempt to develop the characters in a certain way and follow certain stories within the characters that meet a resolution at the end of the second season. Whereas the first was far more action, running around, finding answers. And season two, it feels as though it took a little step back in order to explore things. But that's coming to an end before the end of this season. And it ends on a bang, and season three can pick up on a bigger bang. I loved coming to conventions. They're just the happiest places you can be. People are only here because they like things. No one's coming here because they dislike the people involved or they dislike dressing up in cosplay. It's purely because we enjoy things. And you don't really get many other places like that. And it doesn't matter who you are, how old you are, or what your background is. You can come to a convention and it's just fun. It's just nice. It's friendly. And if I wasn't here working, I'd be here dressed up. To everyone watching Sleepy Hollow, thanks so much. And everyone, I think, will be at various points within the second season. Some have finished it, some are on their way. Thank you, and I'm pleased that there's a third season so we can give you more.
Yeah, having a blast. It's always amazing just meeting the fans and meeting the various different people. And it always surprises me just how fascinating the amount of passion that people put into the shows. It's always very humbling. I think in the UK, where we're up to at the moment is we just had the mid-season break. They've just revealed a lot about Abraham, where you've discovered a whole backstory about Abraham, about the fact that he never chose to be the Headless Horseman, and he had this curse afflicted upon him. And just at the point we've left it, Moloch has been born onto Earth with the Shafar sounding, and it seems like things are incredibly dire in Sleepy Hollow. people seem to be really conflicted about Abraham, which is one of the things I really wanted to try to achieve with the show, is that he's ostensibly the Horseman of Death is the baddie. So ostensibly, having the Horseman of Death as this juggernaut of death is the guy that you're not supposed to root for. But by giving a little bit of backstory about him and getting a human side through Abraham, you get this perspective of the Horseman of Death that actually makes people sympathize. And if you start sympathizing, therefore rooting a little bit for Abraham, and if you root for Abraham, then by proxy you root for the Horseman of Death. So it's creating this really interesting juxtaposition in the show. Well, what happens when we get back after the break is you start exploring how Katrina and Abraham's relationship can grow, as Katrina starts to almost get Stockholm syndrome, as she starts to sympathize with the man who's become her captor. What does that mean for their relationship, and is there any chance that Abraham can actually turn good? So that's what gets explored. Yeah, it's great fun because it's such a big ensemble cast. A lot of the scenes are really diverse. You get to work with all the different people, and they're all fantastic in their own right. Yeah, we laugh a lot. I actually really enjoyed episode 10, which just aired the mid-season break in Britain. So huge sword fighting scenes with Tom and some really fun character stuff. Well, I used to be a boxer, so fighting stuff always came fairly easy for me. But whenever we do a fight sequence, we'll work with the stunt coordinator and the fight choreographer and spend 2 or 3 days working on the fight sequence to learn it and get it going. And then me and Tom will come together and really hone it to make sure that we can put all the character beats in. So a lot of work goes into see those minute fight sequences that end up on screen. I think the unique selling point is there's nothing unique about it in the fact that it's so diverse. It's got action, it's got adventure, it's got horror, there's a little bit of gore, there's thriller, there's suspense, there's love stories. So the unique factor is the fact that it crosses all of the gamut, so there's something in there for everybody. So it doesn't have its hat firmly in one type of show or another type of show. It's so diverse that it just makes it fascinating. I really enjoy Tom's character. I mean, I think Tom just does a fantastic job of the fish out of water side of things, of the man out of time. And I really enjoyed watching what Tom does. He's always surprising and interesting in the choices he makes. Yeah, incredible. He's really generous, super friendly, incredibly professional. All the things that you'd imagine from Ichabod Crane. I mean, my favourite episodes have been ones that they really bring in some of the creature characters. I mean, I think that they've got such an amazing makeup team and VisFX team over there that they create some incredible creatures. My favourite one was the Pied Piper that we had, which was a really fun character. And so seeing those kind of characters and seeing these guys battling these super villains is really fun. Thank you so much to everybody who's watched Sleepy Hollow for the last 2 seasons, and your support has been phenomenal. It's been great meeting and talking to all of you on social media and finding out what the show means to you. And I'm so grateful to all of your support that we've ended up getting a third season. So thank you very much.